Hi there, it's Peter aka Hawkeye, and finally today is the day we are releasing the new MIDI-Fi looper. We have demoed it in some videos and I don't want to go too much in technical details, so this basically will be a build video tutorial. Hope you will enjoy the build. Every step is documented in thorough detail, so it should be easy to build it if you ever had a soldering iron in your hands. This is the new metal case. It will be available in 2020. It doesn't have the full panel artwork yet. We are working on that. Available is this acrylic variant with the acrylic case. This is also nice as well. And yeah, I'd like to say thank you to Andy, aka Letigit On, who realized all of the PCBs in there. He designed them, and that was really a tough job. Very good work. Of course, Thorsten, aka TK, he created the MIDI Box universe, which this basically is based on. Then Adrian Hellig, who creates this fantastic case, will be very awesome. And of course, Adrian Smith, who gave some inspirational thoughts about a perfect looping device. We've integrated some last minute features like a new menu system with two button finger haptic memory. It allows you to very quickly switch between pages. We have a shift system which allows mutes and unmutes from everywhere. And we also have an integrated help system. So on every page you get an explanation what is going on. I hope you like this device and that you have lots of fun with it and have fun building it. See you! Okay, let's begin building. We will start with a few SMT ICs, namely the first one will be the 74HCT125. And yeah, let's get one out. The tools we require will be pincers, like this one, SMT pincers are fine. Normal soldering iron, normal size tip is good, and then normal solder, 1 millimeter is fine. And the Kester flux pen number 951, this will help a lot with these SMT parts. The soldering braid of good quality will also help from time to time. And a loop or a magnifying glass to see if all was soldered correctly. Now first we always align, that's for every SMT part, the part with the silk screen. So there's a marking on the part, there's a line, also there's a notch on the silk screen, so we align those. Then we solder a single pin and then we check the alignment again and then push the SMT part on so that all pins align with the pads. This can take a few seconds, you might need to warm it up again and move it around, and when it's nicely done, we solder a second pin on the side. Then use the Kester flux pen and just drag a little bit of solder onto all of those pins. The flux will usually make sure that the solder only sticks to single pins and that there are no bridges. And yes, now we can continue with the other side. Just use a very tiny amount of solder and just drag it along the pins, and that will usually work out very nicely. And it can also be corrected fairly easily if there's a bridge. So that's how it should look like. Always control your soldering after each IC you solder. It makes a lot of sense to control it directly afterwards. Next up, we are going for the 74HC595. That's a digital output shift register chip, and it's going here. We are marking the alignments of the notch with the alignment, with the marking on the IC. It's just the ST symbol here, marks pin 1, align them. And same as before, solder two pins so that it's stable on the PCB, and then you can do some drag soldering on one side. Now we managed to get a bridge. It's easily corrected by using some desoldering braid. Then that sucks away all solder. Then you could reflux it again and solder those pins again, and then it will be perfect. Okay, then check all pins that they are nice, and then you can solder the other side with the flux pen. Such a drag movement
when all goes well, it just takes a few seconds to solder 8 pins, so this is a lot faster than soldering, for example, through-hole technology ICs. Now we're going for the 74HC4049, and this of course is all ICs also has a marking. We align that with the marking on the silk screen, and same method as before, just fasten one pin, then make sure that all pins match the pads, then you could fasten the other pin on the same side, then use some flux and some easy drag soldering. Not so easy this time, just suck away some excess solder, and in the end all is fine. Don't forget the other side, and when it's done, check it with a magnifying glass or a loop. Then we are done. Next up, some 100 nanofarad SMT capacitors. These are our standard capacitors, and we require them for power input power stabilization of all ICs, so you will find them in a lot of places. And just get out 3 from your SMT box, and here we are just tinning a single pad and using the pincers to push on the components. Attach a single side first, then turn over the board and solder the other side. It's really easy to do and fairly quick. Next up, some 22R SMT resistors. These are up here, and there's some silkscreen marking that show how the part should be installed. So these are lines, and the parts must follow those lines. In this scenario, they are horizontally aligned. Same as before, solder one pin first, then push on the component, then solder the other, and we are done. Next up, we have a TVS protection diode. That's a USB protection diode on the backside. Now this is a 4-pin part, and it has one larger pad. And this one larger pad on the PCB must align with the larger pad on the IC. Using a loop, you will find it here on that screen. It's the upper. Now it's the left lower side of the IC, of the diode, and this must match with the bigger part. Then you just tin a single pin and make sure the alignment is right, and then push on the part so that the bigger pin matches the bigger pad, and then you're fine. Then you can solder the remaining 3 pins and check once again with your loop, and you're done. Next up, we are going to solder the SD card socket. It's an SMT part as well, but it's fairly easy to solder because it has 2 notches, and they will just slot in some holes on the PCB, so it will align really nicely. First, solder the stabilization pins. Now it's already quite firmly fastened to the PCB. Now there are some fairly small pins, and you can use the flux soldering method again. If you managed to create a bridge like I did, just use desoldering braid and remove excess solder, then you can re-solder those pins if you really want to. Probably it's not necessary. Check again for an unwanted bridge, and like that, it looks nicely, and that works. Next up, we have some 1N4148 standard diodes in these locations, and these are polarized components. So on the silk screen, you always see a line, and on the diode, you see a dot or also a line. Make sure you align those lines on the parts with the lines on the silk screen, and the orientation of the part is correct. So that's what we are doing right now. Bending them, align the line with the line, and insert them. When all are in, check the polarity once again, so you're really sure that you did align them correctly. And then I use a plastic tool, a container, that shifts my PCB upwards so I can top solder the parts. This makes a lot of sense, just speeds up the process. And we will require to do that in the next steps with other PCBs. When you've soldered them, check the soldering joints if they're all nice. Then you can turn it over and clip away the excess pins. You can clip them away quite short to the PCB so that they are not using a lot of space vertically, and then we're done. Next up, we have some 100R resistors in these locations up here, and we have another one showing later on. Bend it to the right size, then you can insert the part and put it on your plastic container or other PCB holder, and then you can top solder it again and clip away the pins. And we have another 100R that is up there. And can be top soldered again. And then you can clip the pins quite short to the PCB. Next up, 220R THT standard resistors. We need a few of them. And they go in here. And here I'm just top soldering them instantly so that I don't forget to solder them. This makes some sense if the parts are all over the PCB. This way you can be sure after inserting them that you have soldered the part, and then you can, so to say, forget it. So here are the next few 220Rs. Here is one. Over there. In here. Sometimes you may require to use a tool to pull them in. That's why I prefer SMT parts. That can't happen there. And here is a vertical one. In general, always refer to the BOM, the Bill of Materials. It will list all parts in all locations. If in question, the BOM is always the right resource. So sometimes some silk screen values may be wrong, but in the BOM it's always the correct value. So that's the last one. Some more top soldering, and then we can turn over the PCB and just clip off all pins. Really clip them close to the PCB, because if you have an acrylic case, you won't have that much space vertically there. And then we're done. Next up, we have a single 560R THT resistor. It goes in there, same as before. Top solder it and then clip away the pins. Always make sure to protect your eyes, these are flying missiles. Okay, let's continue with some 1K THT resistors. We need quite a few of them. And we're going to top solder them just as we did before. So here they go. First one goes in there. I always solder them instantly as before so that I don't forget that one, that it has been inserted. And it might be quicker if you first insert them and then solder them, but there's the slight chance that you would forget to solder a pin, and that would be annoying. So it works nicely that way. only a few more to go. This is the section of the status LEDs. If you're using different types of LEDs there, you might want to change the resistor values to adjust the brightness. But for the LEDs that are in your kit, these 1K resistors are perfect for those 8 LEDs. Looking good. Now we can turn over the PCB and clip all pins very close to the PCB. And then we are done. Next up, we have a few 2K2 resistors and just as before, we are using the top soldering method because this is quickest and also the vertical space needed on the bottom of the PCB is minimal, it's non-existent. It's also very close to an SMT approach. Sometimes when you create a mess, just use a vacuum pump and get rid of excess solder. It's easily resolved. Then again, turn over the PCB and clip away all pins very close to the PCB. That's done. Now we have some 4K7 THT resistors. Three are required in these locations. Just instantly solder them that you don't forget those pins. And clip away the pins close to the PCB. That step is done. Now we have some 10K THT resistors. These are also the last THT resistors for this PCB, and they go in these locations and over here. So we require 4 of them. Some more top soldering. And when the last pin is soldered, you can again turn over the PCB and cut all pins very close to the PCB. And done. Next up, we're going to install our front side status LEDs. Now, the color of those you decide, either green or white is in the kit. And there's this longer pin, and the longer pin always goes to the back side. So it's quite easy to install. Now to determine the color, there are two tricks or two ways to do this. Use a coin cell. The longer pin is the anode. Just hold that to the anode or the plus part of that coin cell, and then you can make sure that you have the right color installed here. So then you have to bend the legs of the LED so that the LED fits in on the printed area. These are white LEDs. This is a green LED, and we want to use a green one in there. It's another green one that goes into the power pin, a white one goes in the third, a white one goes in the fourth LED slot, a white one goes in the sixth, another white one goes in the seventh slot, and another white one goes was in the 8th slot. So, but it's your decision which colors you want to use. I usually use green for the power LED. And now, again, just do some top soldering. This is basically to tack the part. We will adjust the alignment a little bit later on. You can use your pincers there to bend the parts if they're not completely aligned. If you could do better work here than I did, but no worries if they're not perfectly aligned or in a row. You won't see that. Either you use the acrylics or acrylic case, then it will be invisible anyways because it's behind a bit of transparent acrylic, or in the metal case it will be invisible too. When that's done, the alignment is done, solder the other pins from the bottom and then clip away the pins very close to the PCB. We don't want to use much vertical space here, as you see. And then the step is done. Next we have a 10 microfarads polarized capacitor. It's important to install it in the right polarity. Now the marked side is the minus part, and that goes not where the plus marking on the PCB is. So here the plus marking is on the bottom side, the minus goes to the top side towards the MIDI ports. That's easy to know. Then before soldering, bend it over to the side so that it doesn't use up vertical space. You can just click it in so that it's on the resistor, so that it touches the resistor, and then just solder it on the bottom side and make sure to really cut those pins close. Next up, we're going to install some optocoupler standard IC sockets, 8-pin IC sockets. These have a marking, a notch. Make sure to align the notch of the socket with the notch on the silk screen. Then you can just drop them in. When they're in, you can use a tool like this plastic ruler and turn over the PCB. And again, just solder single pins at first, only one pin per IC socket, so to tack those parts. Then you can turn over the board and push down on the IC socket with your finger so that it's completely inserted. Sometimes there's a little bit of movement going on there, and yes, this makes sure that the socket is all the way pushed down. Yeah, and then you just turn over the PCB and solder the remaining pins. You could re-solder the first pin that you used for tacking so that the solder point looks a bit nicer. And then we're done. Then we have a 100 nanofarad THT capacitor, and this is not polarized in any way. Doesn't matter, just insert it. And then you can turn over the PCB and solder the pins. Make sure to cut them very closely to the PCB again. Then we're done. Next up, we have a reset switch that's mostly useful for development. You usually won't use or require that, but we have included it anyways. This is a very small switch and it all only fits in one orientation, so you can just click it in and it should hold quite nicely, won't fall out, and make sure that it's aligned correctly. And then just solder single pin, push it in once more. It's very important to make sure that it's incorrectly, because otherwise it won't fit in the cutout of the metal case. But like this, it's fine. And then you can just solder the remaining three pins and we are done. Next up, we have a USB socket. This is used for powering the looper and for connecting it to your computer. It's just a standard USB type B socket, and this has some holding pins, some fastening pins, and four small signal pins. Now when you push it in all the way, it should be good. We do the test again. We just solder one of those fastening pins and then push it down with our fingers again to just make sure that the orientation is perfectly correct and that it's really pushed down to the PCB. Solder the remaining four signal pins and we are done. Next up, we have a pair or two jumper headers. Use standard jumpers here. That's the normal length of them. I've already pre-cut a three-pin jumper that goes into J15S and selects the voltage of your display. You can use a tool to turn over the PCB and just solder a single pin, then you see it's not aligned correctly. Then use the method again, push it with your finger from the backside while soldering the tacked pin, and you can align it correctly and solder the remaining two pins. Now, when that's done, we can also install this JPA0. You probably won't need it, but I will install it. You wouldn't need to install it. It's for debugging reasons. So if your core hangs, you just install a jumper there and then it goes back into the bootloader and you can reflash your application. Next up, there's the core serial IO header. And this one is this special part, and it's a female header. You just insert that. It will align nicely with the PCB, so we can usually directly solder it. I'm using the tacking method again to check that it's really vertically aligned. A longer header will go through the other two PCBs and it makes sure to check it that it's nice in vertical to all sides. And when you're happy, just solder the remaining pins. Then the step is done. Next up, we have some foot switch and gate in connectors. So 6.3mm and 3.5mm jack sockets. So after unpacking them, let's start with the smaller one first and then the bigger one. Just tack a single pin first, as before, for both of them. Then turn it over and push it down, push down the connector as hard as you can, so that it's really sitting flat on the PCB. That's our goal. Just push with your finger while heating up the tacked pad, and then you can solder the other pins, and we're also done with this step. Next up, we are preparing and installing the microcontroller board, so get this out of the case. First up, we are going to remove those three jumpers on the right side, and we are going to use one jumper to install it in J15S to bridge it to 3.3 volts to the center pin that sets the display voltage. That one is not needed, the JPA0, you could use that, but you don't need that. Then those two jumpers, three jumpers, need to be bridged, so to say. And we want to save some vertical space, that's why we pull the jumpers and then bend over the respective jumper legs and then solder them. This is to gain vertical space because that is at a premium in the looper case. So once those pins are bent, we can just, should look like this, can just use a bit of solder and solder them. And if you want, you can clip off the pin remainders. Also make sure to take a note of the switches. It should be like this. The switch USB should be set to 5 volt in and boot config should be set to flash. When that's done, we can turn over the daughter board and remove the crystal and the accompanying two capacitors for the crystal. Just cut the pins of the crystal and then you can easily desolder it by just heating it up and removing it. And the same goes for those two capacitors. Just heat them up and drag them away with your soldering iron. Make sure there's no bridge between those cap points and we're good. Then align the dot with the dot on your PCB, the dot on the daughter board with the dot on the PCB. Push it in all the way, make sure it's really all the way pushed to the bottom. That's quite important, as said, because space is at a premium. And when you're happy with that, you can turn it over and to make really sure that it's flat, measure the vertical distance if you want. It should be around 4 millimeters. So that's the height we have in the metal case, so that will fit perfectly. That's not the height, vertical height, we have in the acrylics or acrylic case, so we will have to cut the pins. That's a big advantage for the metal case if you want to use that. Next up, we tack a single pin, make sure that it's really pushed down, and then probably that's not necessary, and then solder all of the, I think they are around 100 pins or exactly 100 pins. Make sure to not create any unwanted bridges and continue soldering. It will take a while. It also makes a lot of sense after soldering to control those solder points, just to make sure that there are good solder connections. So I think I'm even using a magnifying glass or a loop there, checking every solder connection. Now, when you're satisfied with that, if you are using the metal case, the following step is not necessary. If you're using the acrylic case, yes, you unfortunately have to do this because we have very little space in there, and this will take about 5 or 10 minutes probably in real time. You have to really cut all those pins quite closely to the PCB. So our goal is to reach a height of not more than 1.5 millimeters on the bottom. And to do this, you just use a heavy tool to clip those pins, but you could also use a medium clipper if you can't reach an area, so to say, when it gets difficult to access a pin. And then use a tool like this to clear up the area, a brush, and then you're done. Next up, we can install the MIDI sockets. These are DIN 5 sockets, and we have also a DIN 8 socket that needs a bit of preparation. Sometimes it comes with a metal clip like this, and this again takes away a bit too much space. So first we get rid of this metal clip. Just use standard tools to drag that off. And after that's off, it's not enough. That's too much space we have here with these pins, with these buttons, they're standing out. And an easy way to fix this is just using a file or a rasp, I don't know the correct English word, and just file it down. And this is done quite quickly. It took me about a minute or two to do that. This just makes sure that this port will fit very nicely in the metal case, because there's next to no space to the backside, and it really needs to be flat. So if you move your finger over, the pins should not be protruding anymore. You can use some air to get away of all the metal parts, the small parts that you filed off, and it should look like this when viewed from the top. Then it's perfect. Next, we need to file down this part a little bit more, because there's a plastic protrusion on the top that gets in the way of the OLED screen, and this is quite easily done. Just file it down so that it gets really flat, and when you got rid of that nip, so to say, that the area is flat, it should takes a bit, it should look like this. It should look like it's flat. And so just that you see in visual comparison to the MIDI 5 port, that's how it should look like. Then we're good. Next, we can install those ports. We have 5 MIDI 5 ports and a single BLM port. That's the 8-pin DIN port. And install them in all respective slots. And you can try to use a tool to turn it over. If it works, all is good. And then you just tack the ports with a single pin first, and then they will hold, they won't fall out, but of course they are not aligned. Next up, the alignment step. Just heat up the tacked pin and then push it down with your finger on the other side, so that they are in vertically and nicely aligned. Do check the alignment. It's really important that they are in completely vertically. And they should also be flat on the backside. You can always test with a ruler if you want, and that's good enough. When you're satisfied, you can solder all pins. Be aware, the BLM or 8-pin connector, of course, has more pins to solder, so let you solder all of them. Make sure of that. Then check again that all pins are done. Very nice. Next up, we are already going to install some software. Now we are launching Maya Studio. You can get that from ucapps.de. Download and install it to your computer, then use a USB cable, standard cable, plug it into your Looper Core, plug it into your computer, then after booting the green LED should light up. Also there's an LED on the MCU daughter board. Then start Maya Studio. You will see no MIDI ports first. Use MIDI in Maya 32 and MIDI out Maya 32 as ports. And then you can connect to the bootloader. Sometimes it doesn't recognize the device. So when that happens, it's a Windows problem. Sometimes just close Maya Studio and start it again. And when you restart it, you will see the device in the left middle screen, that it's all there. Then you can click on Browse and choose the Looper project hex file. You can get that from midify.com, from the Looper project page. When you have chosen that, just click on Start, on the Start button, to begin the upload. And once you clicked, it will take a while, something like 10 seconds, and then the Looper app is already installed and running. Then we're done with that process. Then you can launch Maya Studio again and select the Looper in and output ports, just to validate that the operating system, so to say, is all up and running. Next up, we're going to install the Superflux LEDs on the base PCB. Now, these are soldered to the backside in these slots, and over here we need 13 of them. But before we start soldering, these are some safety tips, so to say. We should do some ESD prevention. So make sure that we are perfectly grounded, so to say, that there will be no electrical shocks. You could use a wrist band for that, or ground yourself on a socket wall outlet. Then solder only at 300 degrees centigrade with your soldering iron. That's important, otherwise it might get damaged. Then heat the pads, not the pins, when soldering. First heat up the pad, then push on the solder onto that, not the pins. Solder quickly, 2 to 3 seconds per pad. Then open the packaging vac bag only just before you start soldering, to avoid drawing in moisture into the LEDs. And that's all not terrible if something happens, because replacement of these LEDs is easy. You also have excess LEDs. You can replace them on the backside, for example. That's easy when the Looper is disassembled. They are reachable. Now we are going to look for the common cathode pin, and to find that we can use our coin cell method. And the trick here is to look for the side that is non-interrupted. There's a little metal, you see some metal strips in the LED, and one of the three pins doesn't have a gap, so to say, it's not interrupted. Use your meter, your digital multimeter, to make sure that you have located the common cathode. So that's that pin that has to be connected to the black cable in your digital multimeter test program. When then the LED lights up, you are sure you have found the cathode pin. Now bend the pins like shown in a gullwing structure, and bend out the common cathode pin lag a little bit like this. It will all be revealed why we need to do this, but first find and locate your common cathode pins and then bend it exactly like this 13 times for the 13 superflux LEDs that you have. Now, installation time, you can just slot them in quite easily and make sure to align the bent pin with the CC, with the common cathode pin, so that it just not overlaps with the hole that's in there. The reason behind that is we're going to install some Mattias switches from the top and they need to go through that hole. That's all the reason why we bent out that common cathode pin. Next up, we're going over to soldering. Make sure your iron is set to 300 degrees and that you don't solder for an extended period of time. Also solder on a flat surface, like my working surface here. Make sure that it's really flat because the Mattias switches go in on top. So you can test with your fingers or see visually, it really needs to be flat on the other side. Then the Mattias switches can be easily installed. I'm satisfied here, it's really nicely, but if it's not flat enough, you can use a finger again, like in the tacking methods before, and just push out the LED and heat up the single pin that you've soldered. So control the flatness of the surface right in this step. And when you're satisfied, solder the other remaining two pins. Don't solder the common cathode pin yet. We will solder them when we are installing the Mattias switches. So continuing with pin 1 of the Superflux LEDs. Checking the flatness once again. You could fix it at this stage also with only two pins soldered. It would work not as easily as before, but it will work. So all is still good. And then we are soldering the remaining pin 3. And we are not soldering the common cathode pin yet. When that's done, just check again that your common cathodes are really correct. So that's the long metal that with no interrupt that goes to the top side here, and that they are bent out, those pins, the common cathode pins. And yes, this looks good. Then we are done with this step. Next up, we are continuing with some TBD 62783 SMT transistors. They are going in on all those places. These are DMOS transistors and gate drivers, basically for driving the LEDs and the superflux LEDs. Now, as all SMT parts, they also have an alignment. Make sure to align the dot on the IC with the dot on the silkscreen. Then attach the IC with two soldered pins on one side. Check with a loop that all pins nicely align with their pads, using a flashlight here so that you can see. And when it looks like that, you can easily solder the other side using our standard flux pen and drag soldering method. You really don't need a lot of flux to solder those pins. As you have seen, the first try to solder this row of pins went easily within a few seconds. So that was a success here. Then, when that's done, you can do that also on the other side and always check with your loop for every soldered IC that all pins are nicely connecting to the pads on the PCB. And then just continue with the remaining ICs or transistors. Thank you. Now, when you've soldered all ICs and checked them, you're done. Next up, we continue with some 74HC595 output shift registers in SMT form. These are soldered as before, as all of our SMT ICs. They're going in here. And yeah, we're just continuing with our drag soldering method. Get them out of your tray or parts bag. Make sure the alignment is right, so that the marked ST logo matches with the notch on the silkscreen. Then tack one pin, make sure that the other pins are aligned nicely with the board, with the PCB. And when that alignment is satisfactory, you just solder the other pin in that row. Okay, over here. And that's good, just solder the other pin in that row, then use your flux pen to flux the other side of the IC, and then just use a little bit of solder and drag it along, and usually it will work out really nicely. That's good here. Then solder the other row, flux again. You need a little bit less solder here because you already had soldered two pins, and check for unwanted bridges again. And when that's done, you just continue with the next ICs. Always make sure that the alignment of the ICs is correct. Now, when you're done soldering, check all ICs again with your loop, and then you're done with this step. Now we're going to install our standard 100 nanofarad power capacitors. They are stabilizing the power supply of those ICs. And as before, just solder a single pin, a single pad, then push on the capacitor and push them all on their respective pads, and then turn over the board and solder the other side. It's a lot quicker than soldering THD parts. And when you've soldered the last capacitor on this side and checked all of them, you can turn over the board, and there's some more on the other side. All of those need to be soldered, and we're doing it exactly as before. We're just tinning a single pad using our pincers to push on the SMT parts while heating up that soldered or tinned pad. And when they're all all in, all parts are in. You just solder the other part. And that's it. Now this step is done. Next up, we have some 100R THD resistors for lighting up the Superflux LEDs, and the silk screen in the current revision of the looper board is wrong here. So it's not completely wrong, but we have substituted the 47R resistors with 100R resistors because the brightness was a little bit high. So if you really want a very high brightness looper, you could install some 47Rs, it will work nicely, but we recommend to use 100Rs in all the 47R slots. So that's what we're doing right now, getting out the THD resistors, bending them and dropping them in. Put your PCB on a plastic carrier so that you can easily drop the parts that they won't, so to say, collide with your desk. Now we have this R17, that's a silkscreen error. R17 also needs to be a 100R resistor. So just follow the pattern. It's always two to skip, two resistors to skip, and then one to solder. When that's done, just solder them in, top solder them from one side and then the other side. Check again that they're soldered nicely, and then you can clip the excess pins off with your tool. Make sure you really cut them very closely to the PCB so that the PCB is really flat on that side, because it will be very close to the top side looper board, and we don't want to have any unwanted contacts there. Looking good. Next up, we're going to install some 220R resistors. They are also for the Superflux LEDs, and as you can imagine, we will replace all the 100R references with 220R resistors. So just get out a lot of them from your box and bend them very closely to the center of their mass, so to say, to their body of the resistor, and drop them in. And over here, we just need to drop them in all 100R references. So always follow the BOM. It always has the latest and most accurate information on which resistors to put where. Don't rely too much on any printed silk screen labels. It could always happen that we replace some values to fine-tune the brightnesses. But this version, and for the looper, this is final. So these 220Rs, they are giving a very nice brightness. When you have soldered one row, just turn over the PCB and solder the other row, and make sure after soldering that you have soldered every pin. It's a lot of pins, so it makes a lot of sense to check again. I missed one there, so yeah, always check it twice. Then you can turn over the board and again snip off the excess pins very closely to the PCB. The reason is the plate PCB will sit in a distance of only 3 millimeters, so very close to the base PCB, and we don't want any unwanted contacts, electric contacts between those boards. And you can cut it at a level at surface level, so to say. Use your finger to feel it, and that's nice then. Next up, we have some 4K7 THT resistors, and these are going in this region and between those transistor ICs. I've already pre-bent a few of them. We don't need R56, so it's also marked as do not fit in the BOM. The BOM is always the reference. Just follow the BOM to see where you have to install, in which resistor slots, so to say, where those need to be installed. Omit R56. And these are left. And then you can top solder them again. When you're done top soldering, check once again and then use your cutter to really cut them again very close to the surface of the PCB. And then we're done. Next up, we are starting with the plate PCB, and the most difficult part here are some SMT ICs again. So we're starting with the 74HC165 SMT ICs. These are basically digital input shift registers. They will register all button or switch presses, and if you turn the encoder, and they will also listen to foot switch inputs. So that's their job. As before, make sure you align the parts right. There's a marking on the IC and a marking on the silk screen. Then tack the IC by just soldering two pins on one side. Then check that the alignment of the IC is correct, so that the pins are correctly assigned with the pads on the PCB. And when that's good, just use your flux pen to, so to say, flux the other side, and just drag solder the other side. And when that's done, you can drag solder the original or the first side, and then that IC is installed. And do that four times. We have four of these input shift registers. Most important thing is to check that the alignment is correct. So there's always a little marking on the IC, and that is always that has to be aligned with the notch on the silk screen. After each drag soldering step, check with your loop that you don't have any unwanted bridges. Other than that, the step goes fairly quick, and we are already done. Next up, we have some 100 nanofarad SMT caps. These are again power filter caps. They provide a bit cleaner power to those ICs we just soldered. Get them out of your SMT components box. Tin one side, one pad first, then push on the component while heating up the pad, and then turn over the board and solder the other side. It's really easy and goes a lot quicker than THT component soldering. Next up, we have some 10K resistor networks. These also this is the part number. These also have an orientation and alignment, and as in all of the SMT parts that we have, fortunately, they have a nice big dot on the case of the package, and align that dot with the dot on the silk screen. As before, we're using our standard method. We're just tacking two pins, two outer pins on one side, and then we are checking that the alignment of the IC is correct, that all pins are correctly assigned with the PCB. And when we are satisfied with that, we are just using our flux pen on the other side and use a little bit of flux on the soldering iron and then just drag the soldering iron to drag solder everything in a few seconds. When that's done, turn over the board and solder the original side where you tacked the IC or the resistor network first. Most important here is to always check for the correct alignment of the part and to use your loupe or magnifying glass after drag soldering to check for unwanted bridges, so if you see them you can correct them, e.g. for example with your desoldering braid. Other than that, it's really easy and goes fairly quick. And we are done with those four resistor networks. Next up, we have some high-rows through-board connectors. They go in the plate. This is the parts number. And they look like this. They have an orientation also. They have notches and align those two notches with the notches on the silk screen. Then use, for example, a book to turn over the assembly. And if they fall out, do that again, insert them, and you can usually just solder them in. The weight of the PCB will push it down and it will be aligned correctly. Just solder all pins and we're done. Next up, on the plate we're going to install our visual indicator LEDs. These are 2x5x7mm LEDs. We have two types. We have 4 corner white LEDs and 14 center green LEDs. Now use your digital multimeter in diode test mode. As indicated, the minus side goes towards the OLED, towards the center. So the plus side, that's the longer pin of the LED, goes towards the outside of the board. Make sure to install always the longer pin towards the outside of the board, then you're good. Also, you can use this PCB holder, improvised PCB holder, and check every LED that you're inserting with your tool, with your digital multimeter, that you have the correct alignment. Basically, the longer pins go to the outside, and it should look like this. Then again, you can use a book to turn over the assembly so that you can solder single pins for every LED first. You can use this for better vertical spacing so that it don't fall over. It doesn't fall over. Then just solder or tack a single pin of every LED. This won't result in perfect alignment of the LEDs yet, but you know the process. You can use your finger on one side to push in the LED so that it's nicely aligned, so that it's vertical to the PCB, and do that 16 times for all 16 LEDs. Try to aim for perfect vertical LEDs so that they look really nicely and that they match with the printed silk screen outlines on the PCB. It may take a little bit of time. The green LEDs, they might wiggle around a bit. Go for the best optical representation so that it looks as nice as you can get it. You can always bend those parts later on with a tool, and it will look nicely in the acrylic case and also in the metal case. When you, so to say, need to bend them, it's no problem to do that just before case assembly. We will come to that step. Okay, when you're satisfied with the alignment, just again, clip off the excess pins and clip them off very closely to the PCB again. You're seeing here, we're just leaving a minor space, maybe a millimeter or so. We don't want any more because of the closeness to the board below. So we don't want any unwanted contacts. When that's done, solder all pins. And we're basically done with this step. Make sure again that we don't have high pins left that are standing out with a big height. So clip them off if there are any. Then you can use your fingers to adjust to some last minute adjustments. Or you could also use a tool if it's not completely vertical. Then you can use a tool to check the height, and for both cases it shouldn't be higher than 7.6 or 7.5 millimeters. So that's our goal. If they are higher, you need to push them in more and solder them again. Next up, we're installing some 8-pin headers on the plate PCB, and they are going down to the base PCB. These are also the headers, they are longer than standard pin headers that are used in the sequencer version for Plus LeMac boards. That's why you see that writing on there. You might have a few left over if you built a sequencer before. So as you can see, they look a little bit longer, and we need to clip them at, we need 4 pieces of 8 pins, so to say. So use your clipping tool to cut them, and you can already install them in these locations as shown. And then basically this top PCB will connect there. Now we have these 5 holes that we will use for spacing. So before we continue, we will use 3 millimeter hex standoffs. They are in your kit, and they will be installed from the bottom, so to say, from the bottom side of the plate. We are using some M2 screws, and we are screwing in those 3 millimeter hex standoffs with the male side, so to say, going to the bottom, and we install them in a V orientation. So you will just see in a few seconds which holes we are using. We are using these 5 holes, and they are perfect, so to say, to so that we can reach the perfect spacing for the entire switches. Now we can use the pin headers and install them from the back side. Just click them in, you will hear a click. And they, when they are correctly installed, you will see they will just protrude a little bit to the top. They will be quite sharp over there, but never mind, we should have a case. On the bottom side, they should be flush inserted to the PCB. Just insert all 4 of them, click them in, and now you can just put on the base PCB to this assembly. And the pin headers, they should just reach through the hole, so to say, that they should come through. And you can feel them with your fingers. They must all be inserted correctly. They won't protrude very long, but they are exactly the right length to be soldered nicely. Now, before soldering, put on the M2 nuts to just secure the correct installation height of this PCB. So when we're soldering, that they're in the right height. We can turn it over again to check if we're really having a 3 millimeter spacing distance. It should look nice from all sides. Shouldn't be any excess space. And then we can just solder those 4 8-pin headers to the back side of the base PCB. Good. Check them once again with your fingers if they are all soldered, and then we can unscrew the assembly. It was just temporary, and click them out again. So remove the board assembly, and we are done with the step. Next up, we are installing the J9A header from the plate that goes downwards to the looper base. It's on the right side of those boards. So this is the female receptacle that goes to the looper base, and these are the long headers. They are fairly long. And I've already pre-cut two of those headers with 5 pins each. If you haven't, you can just use a tool to clip them off. First of all, make sure that you install them on the right side. So they go in here, the J9A header it is. Then install them so that they are vertical. The plastic, it has a little bit different thickness or width. You will see there's a smaller side and a thicker, a wider side. Install the smaller sides back to back of each other so that the pins are fairly in parallel to each other. This makes it a lot easier to install. Then you can just push it on to the other board. Insert the other board, clip that in your screws that you still have in there, and secure the assembly with the M2 nuts once again. And when that's done, it should be fairly easy to push on the female header receptacle from the top side. Just push it in so that it fits in nicely. And that's that. When it's in, you can just top solder this part. Also from the other side. And this interboard connection is done. Now we just need to clip off those pins. They are too long. Just clip them off right above the female receptacle. Just like this. And that's good enough. Now we still need to top solder the headers on the other side. Don't forget that. 10 pins to solder, and then this step is done. Next up, we are already going to install the 4 encoders. These are our standard ALPS STEC 12mm encoders. First disassemble the board assembly once more. Then regarding these encoders, they only fit in one way. They have an integrated push button, so that's the top two pins that are inserted. Just click them in. If they don't click in, just bend together those two side pins. They sometimes are a little bit, you just need to push them in a little bit and then you can easily install them. Then turn over the assembly and look if they're all in. Now, it's really important to push them very flat to the PCB. So we're using a top soldering method again, but before you do some or any top soldering, really use your fingers to push down the encoder to make sure that it really sits flat on the PCB. That's a quite important step. So yeah, just push it down before soldering. Then we can solder the signal pins. Those are 5 signal pins per encoder. And these are top soldered, then the encoders are stable, and then we can turn the whole assembly over and just use your cutting tool to cut the signal pins so that they are again very close to the surface of the PCB, and then just use another tool or the same tool that stabilizing pins. They are not of a really strong material, so I now revert to using the smaller, more fragile clipping tool that worked out. I didn't damage the tool, so you can use that easily. And then just solder these small standoffs. They shouldn't really take up any vertical space, but just solder those stabilizing holes with the remainders of the stabilizing pin in there so that it gets really stable but still is vertically flat. Again, we have the other PCB, the base PCB, sitting very closely, and we don't want any unwanted contacts, so this needs to be really flat also for the encoders. Then this step is done. Next up, we are going to install some board interconnection spacers. We already have those five installed. Now we are going to install a few more, and we are also going to install the display spaces. So these four are going to the display, so we can start with them. These are some 4mm spaces. Make sure you get the right ones out of your parts bag. Use a tool to measure them. So the male side goes downwards toward the plate PCB, and just secure them on the bottom side with a 2mm nut. And just measure and make sure that you really use 4mm standoffs here. Otherwise, the display will not be installed in the correct height, and that would be bad. So these are all 4mm parts. Install them like shown and secure them with simple M2 nuts. Next up, we are making sure that we have 3mm parts going downwards. This wasn't so important before, but it's now really important, because at some point those two PCBs will be connected together, and then the installation height must be correct. So we are using those five, so to say, locations for the downward connection of these two boards. So they look like a V, and the other open holes for connections are going downwards to the core PCB. So what we are looking now for is for a pattern of screw holes that are not occupied, that go to the top, and we are going to install the screws that and the standoffs that go to the bottom of the assembly, of the sandwich of PCBs. So just follow the locations that are being used here. I'm showing them with my fingers, and install them with M2 3mm screws, and use those 16mm female to female M2 standoffs. And we require 6 of these standoffs, all in locations where we don't have any connections between the upper two boards. All the other holes, so to say, go downwards toward the core PCB. So if this sounded a bit complicated for the explanation, the easiest thing is to just look at the picture right now, which screws are in use for the downward spaces, and just replicate it on your assembly. So you just need to install the 16mm M2 screws in these locations that you see right now. All other open screw holes will go to the top side. So these will fit from the top side. Should be no problem to install them. We can assemble everything again. Just push it downwards so that it's really using 3mm spacing between those two boards. Check it from all sides, and now we can use 2mm nuts to secure those two boards together. So this phase of interconnection standoffs is completed. That's how it should look. Next up, we're installing the J9 header on the left side. This is the most difficult header interconnection steps. You might find easier ways how to do this. This is basically how I did it when filming the video tutorial. You can follow these steps quite easily. It's not that terrible. You just need a bit of patience until this is installed. Okay, first we need two of the 5-pin long headers and the known, as before, female receptacle that goes into the base PCB. Those 5-pin headers, there's a trick. We use a tool to push these headers backwards from their plastic holders. So that plastic holder is right at one end of the 5 headers. Like this. And continue that step with the other header assembly. Then we can install those headers, this assembly, from the top side, from the plate PCB, in these header holes with the plastic on top. Then we can turn it over and install the female receptacle. That's almost like we did it before. All is good here. Now the complication is this header also goes towards the bottom PCB, so it interconnects all three boards. And to do that, we push back some headers. I will show you. That's the bottom board. It will go in there in the J8, J9 header, female header that we installed previously. Now, if you try to push this together, it won't work so easily. So we push back one row of headers so that we can first install lower headers and then the upper headers. Just click them in like this. And when the lower headers are in, you can just bend the assembly a little bit and then push in the upper headers. Just use your fingers and push them in. If the female receptacle moves, so to say, the green one, it's no problem. Just push in the headers all the way that they're sitting flush at the bottom of the female receptacle on the core PCB. That's the most important thing here. Then you can or should push together the board assembly and secure it with M2 screws. These will also be contained in your kit. And so just secure them in, they go into the 60 millimeter spaces. So the board assembly is already stable. Now we have the header assembly as shown. This is the green receptacle going into the base PCB. It's not yet soldered, it's not yet installed. And we have the top side of those 5 headers with the plastic part in there. And we really push them down, so it makes sense. Every single pin, push them down very flat to the bottom board, so it has really a perfect connection with the female header at the bottom. So once that step is completed, you can then clip off the top side, because we are going to solder here right now, and the plastic part would, so to say, not be very good here. You can use a fine clipping tool, like I'm using right now, to, so to say, separate all of the pins from each other and then clip them off one by one. So this is a fairly easy process. You will, so to say, destroy the plastic holder, but it doesn't matter because the pins are inserted already. So just continue like this. Maybe you use a medium tool like I did, then you can reach the pins better. And that's how it should look like afterwards. All pins should be pushed down to the bottom and should be cut. Now we are ready for top soldering those pins. And hooray, we have a connection from the top board to the bottom board. Okay, still missing is the middle board, the plate board. We didn't have or we haven't soldered the female receptacle there yet. So we're once again unassembling everything from the bottom side, separate the top two boards from the bottom board, and yeah, now we could just push in or push down the female receptacle if if the pin wasn't bent. This could happen, it couldn't happen for you, but it happened for me. So if that happens, no problem at all. Just use some tools to bend the pins straight. That shouldn't be a really big deal. Once the pins are corrected, make sure all of them are aligned nicely. You can just install it again from the top side, push it on, and that's how it should look like. Now we can easily top solder again. And this admittedly a bit complicated step has been finished. Please leave your comments how you like this step, but it will work out and it's not that terrible. That's how it should look like. Next up, we have some more headers. They are for the display that is controlled by the bottom side and another bus. These need some female headers on the core board, a 5-pin and a 7-pin header. We just install them like this, and we didn't solder them before because we want to stabilize them first with those long pin headers. We need a 7-pin header and a 5-pin header. So once they are cut to the right length, just install them like shown with the black bottom holder to the bottom, and same on the other side. And now we can reassemble the boards again. There are holes in the plate PCB that you can use. They just go through there. And there are holes on the other side as well. So you just thread it in, so to say. And that's an easy job. Make sure the other header connections are in their receptacles. And once that's done, push it down flat and secure the assembly again with M2 screws going into the 16 millimeter hex spaces so that the whole board assembly is stable again for soldering. Once that's done, once it's stable, you push down the headers again from the top side so that the female headers are really pushed to the bottom of the core PCB, and you can, so to say, tack them first. You just push it down the header with your fingers from the top side and tack them so that they're really in all the way. And when you're happy with that, just solder the remaining pins. You can also re-solder the tacking pin so that it has a perfect connection of good solder joint. Once that's done, the female headers are correctly aligned and secured to the bottom board, to the core board. Now we really cut those pins again very close to the PCB front side, front panel, to the PCB surface, like this, like shown, should be below 1 millimeter. And over here it's not that important to cut them really close because there's no other component sitting on top, so that's okay, like shown like this. A few millimeters are fine. And finally we can solder those top pins over here and over there. And when that's done, those headers are also installed. Now, if you're really paranoid, I did this, but I think you don't need to do this, but I just did it for safety reasons because I was unsure at that point. You can use some Kapton tape to just shield this area because the OLED sits on top. Now we are continuing with the OLED installation, but we will see we don't require this Kapton tape. You wouldn't need to install it. When getting out the OLED, make sure you have yourself, so to say, grounded. Avoid electric shocks, electrostatic discharge. That's how it will sit, and you see the Kapton tape is not necessary. No parts are close to the pins. You can install the Kapton tape if you're paranoid to avoid unwanted contacts. We just use standard pin headers for this case. Standard pin headers are enough. They just are installed on the plate PCB, like shown, and then we just put in the PCB, the display PCB on top. Now we can secure the display with some M2 3mm screws so that it's nicely aligned. And when that's done, we can already solder the display side. So that's looking good already. Check again that the solder joints are nice. Then we can uninstall the assembly, disassemble the stack of PCBs, and now we can cut the header pins that went out on the other side. With your medium clipper tool, you should be able to reach them nicely. Cut them that they are protruding about a millimeter from the board, that's good, and just solder them. Then your display is installed. Check again, should look like this, and we're done. Next up, coming to the end, we're installing the optocoupler ICs, which are basically just some infrared or standard diodes and a light sensor within an IC case, so nothing really serious or complicated in there, but of course they have an alignment and orientation as well, so make sure to align the dot on the IC with the notch on the IC case. So in this case the dot always goes to the right side of the board. You might need to bend the pins a little bit so that they fit in their sockets. Just bend it flat on the table so that they're in a 90 degree angle, then they should push in nicely and easily, and we are already done with that step. Next up, testing. That's always the best thing when you can test out if all you did was correct and the unit works nicely. Now, if the screen will flicker, that's because of the camera filming. This is not happening in real life. The OLED has a super good contrast and looks very nice and bright. This is just because of my filming setup. Okay, we are testing all input and output capabilities of the looper. To do this, we're pushing down our common cathode pins of the Superflux LEDs so that we hope that they make contact. These are not soldered yet, but when we are pushing them down with a tool, we have a high chance that there's a contact. Now assemble everything, plug in USB, you had uploaded the app before, and the startup is successful. Again, the screen will look a lot better in real life. Now we are in looper test mode, that's when the SD card is not inserted. We can test every hardware component, that's an extension of the looper application, so we don't require any other apps to test it. What you're seeing is some nice blinking lights. You see the LEDs, the ring LEDs proceeding nicely, all of them should light up. And we see a few of the bottom LEDs lighting up, only a few because the common cathode pins are not really connected yet. But it looks fairly good. We see also three different colors on the Superflux LEDs, that's nice. We have the encoders, we can push them. We should see the push message on the screen. Also, when you do any kind of interaction in the UI, all LEDs will light up so you can more easily test them. We're testing all buttons of the encoders. They are given different button numbers, just ignore them. They are randomly numbered, so to say. Now we're testing the encoder turning. We should see different directions, -1 and +1 for counterclockwise and clockwise directions. And this should also work for all encoders. Now this is looking good already. Now we need to test the button, the Matthias switch input action. And to do this, we have to, so to say, bend this little pin, a test tool for us, so we can manually do what the Matthias switch would do for us, connect those two pads. So once it's bent in a shape like this, you can just insert it in the holes as shown. And when all works out, you should see button press and release messages again on the display. So test every single individual connection every single individual button that they work. If they don't work, you still have chance to fix the 74HC165 ICs, which are, so to say, managing those input events. Right now would be the good time to fix it, because afterwards we will solder the entire switches and you can't separate the top two boards easily anymore. So that's looking very nice. All button events have been detected. Then, these LEDs are not lighting up, these four, because our common cathode pins are not pushed correctly. What we can do here is a little trick. If you have fairly small, thin fingers, otherwise ask your better half or kids or whoever is in your house, you can just push down the common cathode pins with your finger from behind, so to say, and then the respective LED will light up. When we get any kind of color showing any LED lighting up, it's good. So that's perfect. When we solder it, it will be fine. We are testing all of the LEDs here that are not lighting up by just pressing down on the common cathode pin, which is not yet soldered. And the last one, and this works as well. So with peace of our mind, we can now solder in the Matthias switches and be happy that everything worked, looking very good. Next up, we're going for these Matthias switches and their keycaps. First of all, we're going to install the keycaps. So this is an easy process, but it takes a bit of strength. You also have some spare parts, so if you break something, it shouldn't matter, but you won't break it. You just need to put the cap on the table and push in the switch from the top. Just push it down hard and it will click in at some point. It will be pushed on that hard that you won't run any risk of losing that keycap again. So you don't need to worry about the keycaps getting lost. Then make sure that those pins are really vertical on the Matthias switch, because if they aren't, you won't be able to install them in their holes. Then just click them in and push them down hard, relatively hard, so that they're really sitting at the bottom of the PCB assembly. And continue with the remaining 12 keys and keycaps. Once they're all in, really push down every key hard. You can use all your fingers, push them really down so that they're sitting flat on the base PCB, pushing them once more. And then you can disassemble the stack once more. We hadn't screwed it together in the testing step before, so that goes fairly quickly. And pushing it down once again. And now we can solder everything. And now you see we have the CC pin with a part of the Superflux LED. The pin of the Superflux LED goes on there, and one pin of the Matthias switch. Make sure that those pins, those common cathode pins of the Superflux LEDs, really, so to say, reach the pad so that they are not bent overly to one side. And you can use your fingernail to correct if necessary. But here it all looks good. Then we can just solder those pads. Again, solder only with 300 degrees centigrade iron, and solder fairly quickly to avoid any damages to the Superflux LEDs. Now, if you ever have a broken Superflux LED, it's very easy to replace it here from the backside. Just desolder all four pads, and you can just replace the component. It's very easy to replace also when the looper has run for a time, but I haven't yet, so to say, encountered a failed Superflux. Good. Now we are continuing with the knobs of the encoders, and Also, we'll speak about caseless usage. If you didn't get a case right now from your MIDI-Fi order because we were out of cases, you can run the looper without a case. I did so for a few months before the first case was, so to say, ready. And it works fairly nicely because the stack of PCBs is quite durable. It's because of the many interconnections, it's a very stable assembly. It won't look as good, but you can operate it. First of all, reassemble the base PCB, so the core PCB with the upper PCB stack. Just screw in screws. Looking good. Now we're going to install the knobs. And the knobs have knob caps. They should be in your parts bag. So just push in knob caps like this, four times. And yeah, you can just install the knobs. They have a D shaft, so they have only one way how they will fit. But there might be a little bit of wiggle room depending on the country you live in, temperatures, moisture and everything. It might not have a perfect fit, or when it's very warm or something like that. What you can do then, what I recommend to do anyways, because it's an easy and quick step, just use a bit of cello tape, I think, film, and wrap it around the D, the flat side of the D shaft, like shown. Just need a few millimeters of this cello tape, and this will increase the thickness, the diameter of the shaft by just enough, so that the knob will really stick. So there's no chance of any wiggling or the knob falling off or something like that. So this is highly recommended. It only takes a few seconds. It's a reversible step. You can take off the cello tape if you want, and it really secures the knobs to the encoder shaft. And that's looking good. Next up, when you have an acrylic case, you will get these parts. Will look something like this. And many of these parts will have on one or on two sides this kind of protection paper that was used by the manufacturer to avoid, so to say, damaging the plastic when the laser cut through. Otherwise there would be some smudges, and yeah, you just have to pull it off. Just use your fingernails to get a hold of one end and then gently and slowly pull it off, and it usually works out quite nicely. So just do this. Then you can put away all of the parts but the base or bottom part. We are unscrewing our uncased looper assembly sandwich once again, and just taking off the core PCB, and we have those 8 installation points, and now you have to match the backside of the acrylic case with the PCB, so that really these holes line up. If they don't line up, you just have to turn over the acrylic base. Also make sure that the jagged edge is at the top where the ports are. When you're installing it, now use a 10 millimeter M3 screw. Sorry, 10 millimeter M2 screw, and use a washer on the side where the acrylic bottom is, so just that the acrylic is protected a bit. Insert it from the bottom and then install another washer from this side. and a single M2 nut. So that's why we had to cut all of our pin remainders on the bottom of the core PCB very closely to the PCB, because for the acrylic case we really don't have a lot of space vertically. Now continue this with all of the 8 standoffs of those screws. And when you have all screws installed, you can just push on the core PCB when the alignment is right. Here I had to turn it over, just will fit in one way. Like this, it will just, so to say, fit on perfectly. Now we can already test with the back panel. Install that, should be possible to install it, should fit in there, and that's how it will look. Then the top part will be installed on those screws. Now to install the top part on those side screws, we forgot those two side screws, it won't fit in there because we don't have a screw here. So we have to disassemble the unit once more. I'm just thinking here what to do. Those two need to go in there. So, of course, we have to use some M2 screws to fix them. So, we can disassemble them, just unscrew those. Take apart the assembly again, and now use M2 screws from the bottom in exactly these two locations and install the 16 millimeter hex standoffs in those two areas. Now we are prepared for the other hex standoffs, so we can just unscrew them from the top two PCBs, like this one, and install it in the appropriate region of the core PCB. So this one goes in here and that one goes in over there. Now we still have two more 16 millimeter standoffs. And we remove them from the top two PCBs and install them at the bottom. Now, as you can see, there are some 3 millimeter screws in there in the assembly, in the sandwich, and they won't fall out. We will require them later on to fasten everything. Now, we still have 4 M2 screws left, and we're going to install them on the remaining screws that are coming from the bottom of the case. Just use a tool to fasten them. And looking quite good. Now we have this one front side screw missing. It's a bit difficult to install the M2 nut over there, but there's a trick. We can just turn back the screw a little bit with the help of this little tool. Just go back a few turns. And now this allows us to install the M2 nut. Just put it on there. And with a few gentle turns, it connects to the screw, and then you can fasten the screw. And it's done. So the core PCB is firmly attached to the bottom of the acrylic case. Next up, we are going to fix or install the backside of the case, and we are using the method of using M3 nuts with M3 screws that hold down, so to say, the side wall of the acrylic case. Now these are some M3 8mm screws, and they will require such a small plastic washer on top for the correct installation height, and this will also protect the acrylic a little bit from getting scratched from the metal screw. So install the washer from this side, and it would go in those two holes. But first of all, we need to install the M3 nut. It's being held by the PCB, by the core PCB, so it can't fall through. That's a nice feature. it will hold in there, in this M3 nut hole, and then you can just install the M3 screw from the bottom and tighten it, and be very careful to not over tighten it. It happens very quickly that the acrylic will break, so do not over tighten or it will break, just so that it has a loose fit and that it holds down the acrylic. That's more than enough. We have outside clamps that will stabilize the whole assembly. This is just for the inside part of the acrylic, that it doesn't bend in any direction. Do that with the other side as well. Now we can install the top two boards, and just attach it to the bottom. Make sure to thread in all of the headers correctly. Start with the back header, going to the display, then to this with the side header, and then with the front header. Usually this works really nicely and clicks in smoothly. Then the assembly is connected. And now you can use your M2 screwdriver and fasten, secure the screws that are in between the sandwich. These can't fall out, so you don't need to worry about them. They will also be exactly in the right place. You just need to screw them in to tighten them. Then the assembly will be already very, very sturdy, very well assembled. Now the side walls, make sure that the looper font, so these are some cutouts of symbolized looper logo, are installed the correct way, so the L should be at the bottom. Other than that, it should look like this. Just temporarily install them in here. These are the side walls, and next up, the front wall. We should remove the SD card for easier installation. Just goes in like this, where the SD card cutout is on the right side. It should also click in slightly and fit in nicely. Now we are preparing the outside clamps. These will really stabilize the case. So these are basically a combination of a female-female and a male-female hex standoff pair. These two screwed together will give a height of 33mm, so that's the inner height of the sandwich, so to say, of the PCB sandwich. We have these rubber feet, and they will go in the center holes of these slight little notches that protrude from the case, and then on top we can screw in the assembled two hex standoffs with the height of 33mm. Just screw them in and do that for all four locations. Then you have four nice rubber feet on the bottom of the case already. If you can't easily screw it in, you can also remove the sidewall again temporarily and also use a screwdriver to hold down the screw and then just install the clamp hex standoffs. When they're in, don't forget to install the sidewall again. And we're nearly done closing the case. Now we have those sidewall protectors. They basically hide those hex standoffs a little bit visually. You wouldn't need them really, but you can install them and it looks a bit better if you install them. And you could remove the display protection here, but I won't do that because I will continue with the metal case installation in the next step. But here you would do that if you are using only the acrylic case. Now you just slot in the top side of the acrylic case. You can use a tool like that screwdriver to so to say move around parts on the through the holes, so it makes it a little bit easier. And you can also use top side screws, also use the nylon washers here to protect the acrylic. Use those clamp screws to hold down three or four of the sides, even while the other side is not completely clipped in yet. This will help you to clip in everything. Then it works out fairly nicely and easily. In the end, you just secure the rubber feet once again, just fastening those screws. And that looks quite good. It would work like this, but we also want those little clamps that will avoid that the case bends out, because there just isn't, so to say, this is a long acrylic side and the material would bend a little bit on its own. But with those screws, it will be very flat. It will work nicely. Important here is don't lose the screw. Here we don't have a PCB on the backside that will hold the screw, but with those pincers you can really hold it nicely. It won't happen anything. Also, if you lose the screw, it's not the end of the world. You can get that screw out through the SD card hole, no problem. Also, really make sure to not over tighten those screws. If you tighten them up, surely one or two of the acrylic notches will break and you will, so to say, lose the function of this clamp hole. So only very lightly fasten the screw. Also do that with the backside, so that you have eight inner clamps installed for the case. Looking good. That's how it should look. That's how it should look like, and everything should be working now. Enjoy your looper. By the way, you can tune it, this case. So if you want a little bit of vertical spacing, so that it should sit at an angle, you can remove the back two rubber feet and use another part, another M3 standoff, length about 20 millimeters or so, and just raise it on the backside. This is a feature of the acrylic case that the metal case doesn't have yet. And it will allow to use the looper in a tilted mode, so to say. We won't, so to say, add those hex spacers, they are optional. Okay, for now, enjoy your acrylic case looper. And the last chapter, we are showing how we install the looper in the metal case. So this goes a bit quicker than the acrylic case. So if you've purchased the metal case, congratulations. Also, please note the case that we are showing here is a pre-production case. It doesn't have any front panel art. Also, the screw holes are wrong. So we have more screw holes in the bottom than you will have in your final production case. You will only have 8 screw holes. In the end, just install the screws in the locations that are shown in the video and all is good. Use a 10 millimeter M2 screw, install a washer and install it from the back side of the case. just as shown here. We are using this hole first, then use another washer on top, and then add a 4mm female spacer. And the trick here is to not insert it all the way, the spacer, but to leave only about a millimeter or so of topside space. We will use that to install the PCB. Makes it a lot easier to install the PCB. Do that for the 8 screw holes that you have in your case. As said, I will leave open a few screw holes in this pre-production case. We didn't know which holes to use, that's why this case had this many holes. Yours will be, so to say, only have the 8 holes that you see right now, right here. Use them. Okay, now if you have used your looper in caseless mode, which is perfectly valid, you can do that. I have done this for a few months and it worked nicely. Now you unscrew the bottom screws, the 6 bottom screws, and disassemble the sandwich so that you can work with the core PCB. First of all, we're going to attach the core PCB to the bottom side of the case. And as we see, these two 60mm standoffs, they will require to go upwards on these points. So we unscrew them already. And we're going to install them in the appropriate identical locations of the core PCB. Just use M2 3mm screws from the bottom and install those 16mm female hex spacers in these locations. This is important to do now, because afterwards it will get difficult to do. Okay, that's looking good so far. Now we can put the core PCB already in the bottom of the metal case. It should fit in nicely. There's a bit of wiggle room for the screws. You just might need to wiggle it around a bit, but as we didn't have those screws installed very far, it will fit in nicely. Now unscrew the other 16mm spacers. We will use them to fasten the core PCB to the bottom of the case. Also make sure these screws won't fall out, so there isn't any danger if you unscrew those 16mm headers, 16mm standoffs, sorry. Now push down the core PCB a little bit so that it aligns with the screws from the bottom. You can use your hand from the backside, so to say, to push in every screw and screw it in so that the top side of the screw comes to the front, so to say. Now this makes it very easy to install the hex spacers. Just showing you how it should look before and after we tighten the screw a little bit. Now you will have access to the screws thread. Do that with all screws so that you see their respective screws threads. Don't do it with the middle screw thread there, because the MCU board is a little bit in the way, but no problem. Okay, now we need to install 4 M2 nuts in the locations that are shown. These are the locations that will not be used for the vertical 16mm spacers. So the outside corners, one goes here, use a tool to tighten it up. One goes over here. Next one goes in the middle over here. looking already good from the backside, should be perfectly aligned. The MIDI ports should be in the center of the cutout holes. And now this a little bit problematic screw, but it's not really a problem. We just tighten the screw a little bit so that that we have access to a bit of the thread, not the whole length of the screw's thread. And as before, as for the acrylic case, we can now use tool like this pincer and just very smoothly tighten it. Once it has, so to say, a bit of grip on the screw's thread, you can just hold it with your finger and secure that screw. Shouldn't be a problem. Once that's secured, it's looking good. Next up, we are going to fasten all of the other backside screws that aren't fastened yet. So just screw them in. These are the screws the screw holes where we have put some hex nuts on the front side, on the top side. Sometimes you have to turn it backwards one turn, the screwdriver, and then turn it forward in the normal direction. But in the end, it should be very easy to secure it. Now we have these locations that need some 16 millimeter standoffs. You can just install them from the top. Again, so to say, use your screwdriver and fasten the screw. You might need to turn it backwards for half a turn or so, and then forwards. This, so to say, makes sure that the nut that is in between the 4 millimeter spacer doesn't tighten up at the wrong point. Go backwards half a turn and then forwards, and then it will work out very nicely. Then you can fasten the whole assembly. Will be really stable installation. Good. Most important part is done. The bottom installation is ready. Now we can just click in the top board assembly. To do that, thread it in gently with the back pins first, so these are near the display, then the side pins, and then the front pins. Just make sure align the back pins, and then all others usually just click in. It's a very easy process, and then there's a satisfactory click, and then it's already installed. Now we can use our M2 screwdriver to secure those screws that are in between the sandwich that we had put in there in a previous step. They will be already at the absolutely correct location. You just need to turn the screwdriver for a few turns, and then it will really tighten and secure the sandwich. Don't forget those two close to the keys. And the two on the left side. Now it should already be a very stable assembly. So this looks good. Everything in place. Now we can install the top side. So the top part of the case. We can also remove the screen protection. That's your final case. And now would be a good time to correct the 2x5x7 millimeter alignment of the LEDs. So when you put in the white top case part, you will see there might be some LEDs that are not correctly 100% aligned. Take off the white case top and then just use a tool to bend them. So here on the right side, the fourth LED or fifth LED from the top, for example, could be bent a little bit downwards. If you're satisfied, just screw together the case. And here's a trick, go backwards with your screwdriver and forwards. So this makes sure that the already cut metal thread isn't cut again by your screw, and this avoids metal scrapes. Do this for any screw that you're installing that way. Always turn backward a full turn until it clicks down the screw, and then, so to say, use the pre-cut thread and install this screw. Yeah. This is the metal case looper. Hope you enjoyed. It's not the final production case, so the final one will look better with better front panel art. Enjoy!